license and why did you?
Steve, do you have slides?
I'm not actually
going to. Do you have slides?
So I still have to sell my wages.
We don't have a clicker for it.
Oh, sorry.
Hey,
how are you doing?
See
you. Nice to see you too. Thanks
for having
me.
Yes, I can plug it in. Or we don't have a clicker, so you'll have to follow it.
What?
Yes.
I'm Rob. Nice to meet you.
All right, so
so like you can woohoo and cheer, like it's all good stuff. So this is the first one in Sydney, which is amazing. So yes, thank you, welcome. We've got a lot of awesome stuff coming up over this weekend. We'll be your MCs. My name is Stanley.
I'm Sophia.
Thank you, hi. Before we move on, I'd just like to do an acknowledgement of country. I'd like to acknowledge and pay respect to the traditional owners of the land on which we meet, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and their elders past and present. I'd like to also acknowledge that it's stolen land, and it is upon their ancestral land that the University of Sydney is built.
And now, let's get straight into it. It is with great pleasure that I announce our keynote speaker, who honestly barely needs an introduction because his well-deserved reputation precedes him, but here goes anyway. Renowned humanitarian lawyer and fierce human rights advocate, let's welcome to the stage Julian Burnside, who will be talking about what makes us give.
Well done on the acknowledgement of. You might have mentioned we added insult to injury by stealing their children, but that's another point. it's a very important point, actually. By acknowledging the traditional owners of the land, we are paying lip service without doing anything to remedy the harm that we did. And I think it's very, very good that you actually said the key point. So, what makes us give? Altruism is an interesting word. It is understood generally as involving a fairly significant level of generosity and no self-interest. In fact, it comes from a French word, which is derived from an Italian word, meaning others. So it is simply things that you do for others. But generosity is a sort of an instinctive part of it. So what is it that impels us to generosity? Simple fact, human infants are selfish. They are near perfect parasites. And they have to be because they're helpless for a long time. You know, in the animal kingdom, human infants are dependent for much longer than any other infant animals. And their parasitic nature is a reflection of self-interest. And as Paul Keating famously said, paraphrasing his hero Jack Lamb, in any two horse race, put your money on self-interest for a win, because you know it's going to be trying hard. And that's exactly right. Still, it's interesting watching kids develop, because after a few years, you know, age 5 or 6, give or take, they start recognising that there can be benefits in subordinating their interests to the interests of others. They often think that other person will be in a position to reciprocate the favour which they, the child, have done. And the result is enlightened self-interest. The enlightened self-interest explains why, in adult life, parents sacrifice a great deal for the benefit of their children. And the thought, perhaps the unarticulated thought, is that in time, those children will be a source of pride for the parents, or maybe even a source of support in their old age. In any event, it's enlightened self-interest at work. Enlightened self-interest explained why it is that gradually, and maybe reluctantly, people learn the rules of manners. So, and I'm not talking about minor matters of etiquette, but children learn bit by bit that you pass the potatoes down without taking some for yourself, in the expectation of being passed back for you to take some in your turn. The enlightened self-interest also explains why children learn to give up their seat in the bus or the train to someone who is older or disabled, presumably on the assumption that one day, maybe, they'll be old or disabled, although frankly, I pissed off when people offer me their seat. enlightened self-interest depends on the idea of reciprocity. That's the key to it. It would be nice to think it was something more noble, but experience suggests that it's not. Now, Peter Singer, in his book, The Life You Can Save, which is pretty much everywhere this weekend, Peter Singer has a very interesting example, which I've debated with him a couple of times because I have some difficulty with it. It's this. A person has just spent $500,000 on a new pair of shoes, walking back through the park wearing the shoes, and sees a kid struggling for life in the pond. And the circumstances are such that she has to either save her shoes or save the kid. She can't do both. And of course most people, not everyone, but most people would ruin the shoes in order to jump into the pond to save the kid. When I say not everyone would do it, Peter Dutton maybe not. Peter Dutton I think would send a bad message. Should have been. Rescue one that was drowning. Or he might treat them like boat people. And having expressed his concern about them drowning, punishes them if they don't drown. Peter Singer then takes that starting point and then puts forward this additional idea that instead of spending $500 or $1,000 on a new pair of shoes, why not send that money to a third world country where it may save a dozen lives? And that's the point where a lot of people think, yeah, maybe, but maybe not. It's a very interesting question, and as I say, I've debated it with Peter a number of times, and we simply agree to disagree about whether it is a universal response. I think it's not a universal response. Given the disparity between living standards in Australia and living standards in third world countries, it's almost unthinkable that all Australians would give up their living standards in order to compensate people in other countries who are in worse circumstances. And so I think a lot of people might disagree with Peter Singer's thinking, noble though it is, but global altruism is increasing. And I think that can in part be traced to something a little more elusive than a sense of generosity. Some good work doesn't depend on the prospect of the favour being returned. Reciprocity is interestingly relevant. For some people, simply knowing that you've done something worthwhile is enough. Knowing that what you've done is good. Now, I'm cynical enough to think that not every person in Australia or in the world is going to be motivated by that same sentiment, to do good just because it's good. And if it was otherwise, then charities like 80,000 Hours and MSF and Oxfam would get all of the donations and we all gradually moved ourselves to living in poverty, and all the other charities would languish with no supporters because if you want to do good and you can't get in the third world to do it yourself, then the way to do it is to donate to causes that do. But there is a sentiment, I think, which moves some people, even people of modest means, to contribute to their local youth club or their local homeless shelter or things of that sort. And it's interesting and often unrecognised that people who are relatively not well off tend to be very generous. Maybe because they see at first hand what it's like to be in a difficult position. And it is really, really characteristic in groups like Red Cross to see people with very limited means being very generous. They may not be able to give as much as Bill and Melinda Gates can give, but they're generous relative to their own circumstances. And it's this sentiment that it's worthwhile doing good is very interestingly characterised in Primo Levi's book, If This Is a Man. If you haven't read it, I would recommend you read it. Primo Levi spent a couple of years in Auschwitz concentration camp. In If This Is a Man, he talks about his friend Lorenzo, who was also in Auschwitz. And Lorenzo was someone who went beyond any expected or rational lengths in order to try and improve circumstances for other people in the concentration camp. And Levi writes of Lorenzo, "He constantly reminded me by his presence, by his natural and plain manner of being good, that there still existed a just world outside our own, a remote possibility of good, but for which it was worth surviving." That's a fantastic sentence when you think about it. Now, Lorenzo's conduct in Auschwitz, so memorably recorded by Bruno Levi, is an example, I think, of genuine altruism, inspired by generosity with no hope of reward, and its causes, no doubt, lie deep in Lorenzo's past. Now, in the same way, some elusive explanation is often available to explain why some people demonstrate genuine altruism. And perhaps at this fragile time in world history, that sentiment can come from a simpler notion, as was expressed by Lincoln in his Gettysburg Address, where he says, "The world will little note, nor long remember, what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here," talking about the people who died at Gettysburg. Now, for many people whose lives have transcended the daily struggle, which a lot of people, most people, have to experience, for those whose lives have gone beyond that, they come to the urge to repay the benefits which they have had. And maybe that's the ultimate expression of reciprocity. You know, oh, the world has been good to me, now it's my turn to be good to the world. It's the reverse of the enlightened self-interest, because it represents a recollection that there is a debt to repay. But then there are those people who've done well in life, but who recognise how transient their existence is. And the transience of life on this planet is something which I'm increasingly fascinated by. How many people here have heard of Carl Sagan? Excellent. Because Carl Sagan was the Brian Fox of the 1970s. And Carl Sagan was an extraordinary, clever astrophysicist who produced all sorts of interesting things. He produced the first series of Cosmos, which is now being redone by a student of his. And in conjunction with Cosmos in the mid-70s, Carl Sagan came up with a calendar which does something very interesting. Compresses the extreme universe, 13.7 billion years, into 12 months. So the Big Bang is midnight on the 1st of January, the present is midnight on the 31st of December, and all the events of history and prehistory in between those, it lies across the 12 months. The startling thing about that is that you see that the dinosaurs emerged on the 25th of December, and they went extinct on the 30th of December. And our species, Homo sapiens sapiens, we emerged about 10 minutes to midnight on the 31st of December. And the history that we revere from the West, the history from the Reformation to the present, that occupies about the last 2 seconds before midnight on the 31st of December. An average human lifespan, according to biblical measures, represents about 1/5 of 1 second in the calendar that Carl Sagan produced. You think life's transient? Have another look and you will really think of it. So the humbling nature of our transience, I think, is very important. And is all of a piece with the great Persian poet, philosopher, mathematician, Omar Khayyam. Who's heard of Omar Khayyam? Oh, impressive, but few of them can't say you. Omar Khayyam famously wrote a set of four quatrains called Rubaiyat. And one of them says, "The world we hope men set their hearts upon turns ashes, or it lingers and anon like snow upon the desert dusty face, lighting its little hour or two is gone." Well, now at least an hour or two, that's a bit of poetic license, because actually it's a second or two. But it is a really interesting reflection of the transience of existence. And leaving a mark, making a difference in a world where our presence is so brief and so transient, is comforting, because it protects us from the cavernous depths of time and space in the universe. But maybe there's another force at work. Most of us in the course of our lives can think of an episode which has shifted us into a new direction. And certainly speaking for myself, the last 15, 16 years have been profoundly changed by one episode, one specific episode. In the wake of the Tampa episode in 2001, I found myself being contacted a great deal about refugee matters. And the instance that really, really is the cause of the last 15 years or so of my life concerned an Iranian family, mum and dad and two daughters, who at the relevant time aged 11 years and 7 years. They had fled Iran in terrible circumstances, and instead of fleeing north, they fled south. They ended up coming through Indonesia, landing in Australia, being locked up, and they were in Mora. And after about 15 or 18 months in Mora, they were in a pretty bad way, but especially the 11-year-old girl. She had really given up, and a psychiatrist heard about her case, went to Mora to talk to her, to talk to the family, delivered a devastating psych report to the department, in which she said, amongst other things, this child is at extreme risk. She has basically given up. She's stopped eating, she's stopped caring for herself, she's stopped grooming herself, she's stopped brushing her teeth, she's stopped brushing her hair. When he spoke to her, she said she didn't want to be buried in Woomera, she wanted to be buried beside her grandparents in Iran. He said she needed daily psychiatric help, and for that purpose the family should be moved from Metropolitan Detention Centre, because people back then in Woomera who had extreme need of psychiatric help would get to see the visiting psychiatrist roughly once every 6 or 7 months. But she needed daily help. So the department moves the family to Maribyrnong Detention Centre in the western suburbs of Melbourne. And although the reason for moving them was that this kid needed daily psychiatric help, for the first few weeks of their stay in Maribyrnong, nobody came to see her. Not a psychiatrist, not a doctor, not a nurse, not a social worker, nobody. And on a Sunday night, while her parents and her young sister were off in the mess hall having dinner, this little girl, alone in their cell in Maribyrnong Detention Centre, took a bedsheet and hanged herself. But she was only little, she didn't know how to tie a knot, and she was still strangling when the family came back to their cell. They took her down. She and her mother were taken to the general hospital nearby. With Konka Panagiotidis, who's done sensational work in this area. Konka Panagiotidis, who set up the Asylum Seekers Resource Centre, was looking after the asylum claim. He heard about this. He went to the hospital that night, about 9:30, said hi to the guards who had accompanied them to the hospital, so that as a matter of legal analysis, they were still in immigration detention, even though they weren't in the detention centre. And he said he just wanted to speak to the mother to see if there was anything he could do to help. And the guards said, no, you can't see them, because lawyers, visiting hours and immigration detention are 9 to 5. And they sent him away. He then rang me at home. I will never forget that telephone call. And I don't know, do I want to get back at the government? Is it just slow-burning anger? Or is it just one of those things that changes the way you see the world? It's one of those stories that I can recognise as having a profound impact on my life and my orientation. Incidentally, that kid spent 12 months in the Child and Adolescent Mental Health Unit at the Austin Hospital in Melbourne until she was assessed as well enough to be put back in detention, and they put her back in detention. I think there may be other causes. Each one of us in our experience have things that shape the way we respond to circumstances, and which may produce altruism as a consequence. And I've only told this story publicly in very recent times, but my concern as a citizen, I think, is justice. And I know what the cause of my concern about justice and injustice is. And I mention this simply because for all of you, in all of your lives, you will have experienced things that reshape or that shape initially your response to the world at large. And with a bit of luck, it will shape your response to the world at large in a way that encourages you to generous altruism. The thing was, back in the dark ages. I mean, I'm talking 1950s, early 60s. My parents' marriage was in trouble. And that was at a time, which most of you will not remember, at a time when it was deeply unfashionable to get divorced. And so things were difficult for my mother. And she established rules, which we all had to obey, which I obeyed very conscientiously, because I was a conscientious goody-goody. And my brother tended to break the rules all the time, which was terrible. My brother had very bad appendicitis, so I thought he was 9 or 10. And after that, with the benefit of a sunny disposition, he used to misbehave shockingly, break the rules when he felt like it. And there was a conscientiously obeying all the rules, going above and beyond to do what the rules said, and not getting thankful, what I mean getting thankful. And he's breaking all the rules and not being punished for it. I thought that was really unfair. So, you know, keep going at it. But it all came to a head one day when I came home and found that he had done the unspeakable. As a kid, I used to make model ships and aeroplanes. I made a model of the Caesar, a great big model of this three-masted Walter of the 19th century, fantastic model. It was a real work of pride. And I came home and found that Ian had put it on the compost heap and had burnt it to the waterline in a mock sea battle. And I was enraged to an extent that it was almost impossible to communicate. And he didn't get in trouble for it. And I thought, that's so unjust. That is so unjust. It's outrageous. His behaviour is terrible. He should have known better. Blah, blah, blah. Anyway, some years later, he had visited Geelong. Geelong is a city about an hour's drive south of Melbourne. And there was a rule in our household when I was growing up that you don't hitchhike. And he was told you can't hitchhike. So he broke that rule. Couldn't be bothered waiting for a train to bring him back to Melbourne. So he hitched a ride. The driver was a hopeless driver, ran off the road on a curve. The car ended up in a creek. Ian was knocked unconscious on the door pillar and drowned. And the driver walked away unscratched. And it was only after that that my mother told my sister and me that what we had been told was appendicitis was in fact a rare form of cancer, of which only 8 cases were known at that time. 4 had survived to adolescence and 4 had not. So she had a son who was under a death sentence, and she didn't tell us. If I'd known, then the favouritism she showed him would not have seemed unjust. But by the time the truth came out, it was far too late, and I had this profoundly instinctive sense of justice and injustice, and a deep commitment to pursue injustice where possible. Now, I give this as an illustration of the fact that childhood experiences and experiences in later years can profoundly shape our approach to the world. You can call the response altruism if you like. It doesn't really matter what you call it. But you need to encourage it. You need to be aware of its various sources, and if you have the opportunity of showing altruism, whatever its cause, do what you can to give effect to it, because it is what makes this life worthwhile. Thank you.
Thank you, Julian. Thank you. I had full intention to plan everything that I was going to say, but then I got entirely invested, and so this is going to happen now. Okay, so now I just need to go through a few housekeeping things just before we continue. First of all, bathrooms. I know this is going to be really exciting. Bathrooms are just down this way, just on the right, men's and women's, and also up through this exit behind there. Speaking of exits, here, here, and here. Make sure there's no fire outside or those things with the emergency door, they don't have plans. The other thing is we have Catherine Lowe here. Wait, she is our incidents person. So if there's any issues, physical or emotional or otherwise, Catherine's your gal. We also have Luke here, dealing with the camera. Hi, Luke. And also Joni, I think, is somewhere around the place as well. So if you're feeling sick, or if you witness any harassment, or if you're sleepy or bored, any of those things, go to Catherine or Luke. Great. Next thing, catering. We have catering for 170 people. There are 170 people attending, so eat normal amounts of food, not excessive amounts of food. We have gluten-free, it's all vegan, so go for your life, but not your entire life. Next thing, when it comes to phones, we have a couple of little phone things going off in that one. Just make sure your phones are on silent, but also we really encourage you to use your phones. We have the Wi-Fi intermittently coming up on here. Jump on the... what is it, Sophia? What's the Facebook? It's just EAGX Australia, Facebook.com/EAGX Australia. Yeah.
It's the website.
Yeah, we'll be putting links up on there. And that brings me to my next point. We have the amazing guys from 80,000 Hours here this weekend. They've come all the way from California. They'll be doing one-on-one career coaching with you guys, half an hour sessions, but you need to make sure you register. So the link will be intermittently coming up to register for that, and if you need any help, there also our staff members around here will be able to give you a hand with that. It's an awesome opportunity. Make sure you take it. All right, that's my housekeeping. That wasn't too painful, I hope. All right, now it is my absolute pleasure to introduce our next speaker. So that will be Sophia. Sophia is studying mathematics and economics at the University of Sydney. She founded a non-profit organization called the Starfish Collection and has spent the last year as a sole employee of a startup that provides car rides for kids. She's an avid, effective altruism volunteer, your MC for this weekend, and also one of my best mates. So can we just give her a huge round of applause?
Thank you.
Very flattering introduction. So I'll just be giving a basic intro as to what effective altruism is, so everyone's on the same page for the entire conference. So I do apologize if you have had this many times before. So, as you are all probably aware of by now, effective altruism is a global social movement that centers around the question, how can we improve the lives of others as much as we possibly can? And while this may seem simple and maybe even obvious, it is an important and challenging endeavor. We live in a world with a lot of problems, and unfortunately, we can't possibly fix all of them as hard as we may try. Unfortunately, no one here is going to live forever. We'll get 100 years if we're lucky, and none of us are infinitely rich as much as we'd like to be. So we have limited resources to put towards working on improving the world. And so we have to make choices of where we spend our time and where we spend our money. Whether we think about these choices or not, they have an impact on the world. If we give money to one charity, we're not giving it to another. If you have one charity, say in Uganda, that saves 100 lives with the same amount of money as a charity in Australia, then you may consider giving the money to the Ugandan charity and save an extra 99 lives with the same amount of money. And it's not that you don't care about the one Australian sick person. Is that you may also care about the 99 additional sick people in Uganda. So Hayden will go into a bit more detail about how important cause prioritization is, so I'll just leave it there. So another thing that effective altruism cares about a lot is doing your research thoroughly, using reason and evidence to answer our beloved question of how to improve the world as much as possible. So obviously, if we have better tools to answer our question, we'll get a better answer. But I just want to emphasize how hard it is to get a good answer. It's amazing how many people have good intentions. It's really, really inspiring. But so often, you have someone that starts a project, is really passionate about it, has a really sexy story, does it for 20 years, someone does a randomized control trial on it, and it turns out that that program had no effect or even a negative effect. So a bit of a parable within the EA community is an organization called Playbox. So Playbox received a $10 million grant from the US government. It was announced by First Lady Laura Bush. It received a World Development Marketplace Award and even a site visit and sponsorship from Jay-Z. So the media was all over it. The idea was simply that it was had a merry-go-round that was also a water pump, and the kids would play on it, and that would pump water for villages in the developing world. So the international media swooped in to report the story, you know, making headline puns like pumping water is child's play and the magic roundabout. The founder, Trevor Field, was reported to say, "It really rocks me to know we're making a difference to a lot of people who are nowhere near as privileged as I am or as my family is." However, Playpumps is not the magic solution the media had painted it as. Unlike usual merry-go-rounds, it didn't run freely. When you pushed it, it required constant force to play on it. So of course the kids didn't want to play on something that required a lot of work, because half the fun of a merry-go-round is just for it to spin round and round frictionlessly. So if it's used to pump water, you need constant force and it's no longer any fun. But they were put all over Africa, replacing the water pumps that were already there, meant that the water still had to be accessed. So it ended up the women of the village had to undergo the demeaning task of pushing these roundabouts to get the water. And it's a lot more work than a normal hand pump. They were more expensive, and they both broke frequently and had little support when they broke down. David Anderson, the Director of Evidence-Based Policy at the Laura and John Arnold Foundation, estimated that the percentage of programs found to have weak or no effects were rigorously evaluated at around 75% or even higher. I don't want to get everyone down. It's definitely possible to answer the question, how can we do good? But it's hard, and you really have to do your work to do it well. So some safe bets include things like insecticide-treated malaria nets to prevent mosquitoes from biting children while they sleep. And so you put the bed net over yourself while you sleep, and then the mosquitoes can't bite you, so you don't contract malaria. A great place to start for World Resource Charity Interventions is givewell.org. So I highly recommend checking that out. So I'll just quickly cover, since I'm doing what EA is, what EA is not. EA is the question of how to improve the world as much as possible. It's not a set of conclusions. We don't have all the answers. It's just a community of people who really care about this question, so we put a lot of thought and a lot of research into it. But we do not have perfect information about our beautiful and complicated world. The chances are there are better answers out there. So while we probably have much better answers than if we had put no thought into this at all, we definitely are always looking for the next best way to improve the world, because we definitely don't have the best answer. Because of this, it is so important to be able to update your beliefs when you're given to a good reason. I strongly encourage, while you're here, I'm just going to jump back into MCMO quickly, be willing to listen to people's views and change your mind if you're given a good reason to. And on that note, if you are having interesting conversations while you're at this conference, We strongly encourage you, while we've got a great set of speakers who are really interesting, continue on your conversations if it's getting somewhere out in the foyer, because we're here together. A lot of the purpose of this conference is to gather like-minded people who want to improve the world, and if you're having a really high-value conversation with someone, that may be very, very well the best use of your time. Finally, people within the effective altruism movement are big fans of actually doing it. And as fun as it is to philosophize and ponder on angles of how to improve the world as much as possible, the whole point is to actually do it. So act on your best guess, and some common places to start would be perhaps considering giving a proportion of your income to GiveWell.org recommended charities. Maybe you care about animal lives, reducing your meat consumption, or even if you care about future lives, you might consider working on reducing the risk of humanity's extinction during your career. So hopefully you have plenty of chances to have some interesting conversations and be pointed to some brilliant resources where you can read more. So I strongly encourage you at the end of the conference to get out there and act on your best guess on how to have as much impact as possible over your lifetime. So, in conclusion, what is EA? It is the question, how can we help others as much as possible over our lifetimes, using reason and evidence to get the best answer we can? And then actually acting on our best guess to work out something better. All right, that is that. I'll now introduce our next speaker. He is currently a Masters of Philosophy candidate, an undergraduate tutor at the University of Adelaide. His thesis looks at the neurobiology of how animals update where they are and where they're going, and in particular, he looks at the artificial neural network models of this. His talk topic is Why Do Good? So please welcome him on stage with a big round of applause, Robert Bacarson.
Please, mingle amongst yourselves.
Okay. That was bad advice to mingle amongst yourselves. Hi everybody, I'm Rob Clarkson. It's great to be here again, and I love coming to all kinds of effective altruism events. It's always a smart, inspired, passionate group of people. So it's impossible to leave without learning something new or feeling inspired about some new area. So it's great to be here, thanks for coming along. And contrary to the Sophia's advice of actually doing it, I'm going to encourage you to just sit here and ponder. So yes, I'm a philosophy postgraduate at the University of Adelaide, and yes, this isn't actually what my thesis personal research is about, but it's something that definitely keeps me awake at night, hence the involvement in effective altruism. So yes, I'm going to talk about why do you do it in the first place? Why not act in your own interests? And the subtitle, I call it Ethics and Normativity in a Natural World, because I think that's the sort of lane that effective altruism brings to this question. So it's ethics and normativity. Normativity is just a philosophical word for things you ought to do, right? There's a sort of power to it. You should do it, you need to do it, you must do it. So morality, philosophy, but then in a natural world, right? We want to do this, we want to bring it back to Earth, we want to do this in a secular fashion, a secular framework, and apply the tools of science to this question of why we should do good. start off with a little bit of a story. Has anybody heard of the story of the scorpion and the frog? Yeah, a couple of people. Right. Okay, so one day there's a scorpion walking along the banks of a river, and he sees on the other side of the bank a great scorpion club. He wants to go hang out there with all his buddies, but of course scorpions can't swim. So he sees a bunch of frogs on one side, and he says, "Look, I can't swim, Mr. Frog, so can you take me across the river?" And the frog says, "Well, no, you're going to be insane, right? You're going to sting me." And the scorpion says, no, why would I do that? I want to get to the other side of the river. That's the place I want to be. And I can't get there by myself, so I need to cooperate with you. So I'm not going to sting you, because if I sting you, you'll drown, and I'll drown." Frog goes, "All right, that's a pretty good reason. All right, I'll take you across, jump on." When they're about halfway across the river, the scorpion stings the frog. Frog starts drowning and, you know, cries out, "Why? Why have you done this?" And the scorpion just lamentingly says, "It's in my nature." Now, don't be too despondent. I don't want this to be a depressing story, but I think what this highlights is, it's an important question. Why did the scorpion do this? If he wanted to get across to the other side of the river, why did the scorpion sting the frog in the first place? And so what I think this highlights is the difference between motivations, as in causal things that move us, and reasons for action. And what I think this skirts is a philosophical problem called the is-ought gap, as you can see by the picture up there. It's commonly thought that scientific statements, descriptive statements about the way the world is, can't inherently get you to statements, normative statements, the way that they ought to be. But I think this is a bit of a confusion, and one of these confusions is demonstrated by the frog and the scorpion. There's a difference between things like psychology and morality, okay? So, you see that psychology and the scorpion's nature was what actually physically causes the scorpion to move. But then morality was what the scorpion really wanted to do. So on one side we've got facts about the way the world is, you know, this is something like neurobiology, but more importantly we want to talk about how that scales up and how our neurobiology interacts with the sort of incentive structures in our wider environment. And things like cognitive bias, like how does our thinking and reasoning go systematically wrong? And on the other hand we've got, these values that we design, we want them, and then what do we do to get towards them? What do we need to get towards them? And I think conscious well-being is at least one uncontroversial value that we can all agree on, right? We saw that yesterday from Benjamin Todd. Okay, utilitarians think this might be the only thing that's of value, but most of the other theories still agree that it's at least one of the values, so that's pretty uncontroversial. And then the other things that we want that sort of lead towards greater well-being. Things like a peaceful, pluralistic world, and things like material prosperity. So then, first, before we make decisions about what we ought to do, we have to decide, what is it on the other side of the bank that we want to get towards? And so, as I just briefly alluded to, I think conscious well-being is definitely one of these things, right? We just need to look, introspect a little bit on our own conscious experience, and we find that it falls on this spectrum of possible experiences. So the photo up there is from Syria, I think from 2015, when the civil war was getting, does it get any worse at any point? But, so it's during the Syrian civil war, and we can all agree this is a pretty bad state to be in. It's not exactly a prosperous state for humans to live in. And it needn't be that way. Right? We could solve our problems diplomatically and without resorting to violence. And on the other hand, you have the Dalai Lama where Ray Nance. He's feeling pretty good, okay? So it's not that everything the Dalai Lama does is necessary for us to live a good life or have lots of conscious well-being. But just imagine what it's like to wake up as the Dalai Lama. It's probably a very fantastic headspace to be in. And so anyway, this is the sort of direction that we want to push conscious experience in. We want to move away from these sorts of disastrous crises and move everybody in the world over closer towards being the Dalai Lama. Okay, and again, a little bit jokingly, the world is a prison, but a prisoner's dilemma. And I hope some of you have heard of this before. And this is how we start to mathematize what we ought to do to get towards that other side of the bank, getting people towards having greater well-being. So the prisoner's dilemma is just, we have two prisoners who have been caught committing a crime, and they're told they have options. They can just confess and rat out their buddy, in which case, you can see, they get a reduced sentence, their buddy gets an increased sentence. But if they stay silent and their buddy confesses and rats them out, the reverse happens, right? So we begin to see how self-interest is an unstable strategy for interaction in a sort of community setting, because if I know that my buddy's going to rat me out, I'm probably more likely to rat him out too. And if we just keep doing this tit for tat, right, it's got bad outcomes, it's got worse outcomes overall compared to if we both remain silent, you can see up there. The best strategy is to keep quiet, because then we can both just get reduced all the lost amount of time. Okay? So sorry for that very brief introduction to the prisoner's dilemma. But this is just a mathematical tool that we use in particularly in economics called game theory. So, this is how we mathematize. We can all agree that the value point in this setting, right, is reduced sentence. That's where they want to be. So that's the value. But then what's the framing of the problem? That's sort of how the police are interrogating the prisoners and telling them what their options are. But then the knowledge about how your choices will affect other people and other people's choices affect you. And again, this was something that I think Ben was alluding to last night. It's the, I think he called it the single player fallacy or something like that. We often think that we're just acting alone, but actually our choices affect the choices that other people make in the future as well. And so we want to make, what's the best strategy to keep on a stable path for everybody, rather than just going tit for tat? And so, think about it as, you can think about it as the frog and the scorpion, right? What's the best strategy? Now, given that first example, the other frogs sitting back on the bank, I've seen the scorpion sting their buddy, and I'm probably going to never help the scorpion again, right? But our dilemma is slightly more complicated, but nonetheless, we can still think about it in rational and objective scientific ways, because our value state is the mental state on the left. We can study those, because we think, at the very least, they somehow reduce to brain states. Okay, we don't have a full theory of consciousness yet, but we know that, you know, without a brain, there's probably no mind, okay? But then our mental states cause our behavioral states, how we behave in the world. We can study those scientifically. Things like psychology, sociology, economics. And then the world is just a collection of all of our behaviors, okay? And, well, that's just economics again, politics maybe. And then the world that we find ourselves in will physically impact back upon our brains. And, well, brains are just physical, so we can study them scientifically too. And then that finally leads back into our mental states. So it's slightly more complicated than our prisoner's dilemma or the scorpion control. But nonetheless, we should be able to mathematize it in the same way. It's all just physical stuff. And I think most of the controversies, and maybe Julian's dilemmas that came up last night, are where it's not quite clear. We have these really clear cases on both ends of the spectrum, things we shouldn't do and things we should do. But then in the middle, it gets really hard. And these high impact ignore these mundane, tiny choices that seem to have no payoff at all, or we just can't even begin to compute what the payoffs would be. But nonetheless, this is sort of what we're doing. We have these various dimensions of value that we think contribute to an individual life and what makes somebody feel good, have conscious well-being. Things like wealth and health. And so we just have various values for them. These are just arbitrary, just a visualization. But then what we find is that they're not independent variables. They sort of co-vary together. And as we sort of make changes to one, the others may change. Okay? So this person has increased wealth, but their physical health has suffered. This person obviously works out a lot, but hasn't really paid attention in school. But what we want to find, right, is the best balance. Like, how do we balance all of these variables together? Okay? So they, as you target one, the others change. But we want to, using that web of interdependent areas of scientific inquiry, we want to study how best to just level them all out. Where can we get the best balance for an individual? And of course, that's going to be individual. It's going to be idiosyncratic because we're all different. And so then we get the second level of gray areas and trade-offs is between people. So not just between individuals, but the same sort of thing happens. As one person's wealth or well-being increases, we can sometimes see how that interaction maybe lowers somebody else's, in the short term, maybe. But this, it's the same thing, where we have these trolley cases that we can't really decide. One person's well-being goes up, somebody else's goes down. But nonetheless, in principle, we should be able to make logical, objective decisions about what we should do, because we just want to find, again, the best balance. Okay, so to wrap everything back up, why do good? Well, I think it's actually a little bit of an existential dilemma as well. It's not just about rationality and science, but wisdom. We're here, we're at the banks of the river already, all right? There's always going to be some non-natalist, if you study philosophy, you might know what that means, who argues that life is not worth living and it's better off never having existed at all. But, okay. Forget them, they're always going to be the contrarian in the room, okay? But what do we do with the lives that we have here, now? I think we're already standing in the stream, so we have to make a choice. The river's flowing, time's moving forward, we have to make choices. And there are definitely uncontroversial ends, okay? Everybody agrees that morality, ethics, the choices that we need to make in our lives, we don't want to make the world worse. What we're disagreeing about is how to avoid making the world worse, or how best to make the world better. But nobody thinks morality or ethics has something to do with destroying everything, okay? So we want people to live happier, better lives. Well, given a sort of scientific approach to that, we definitely have the tools available to study how they come to be, and then how we can best bring them to fruition. And just to wrap up, I don't want to be the scorpion, okay? I don't want to be the scorpion that stings the planet, the frog planet, okay? I don't want to bring down planet Earth. So that's why, again, it brings effective action back to our personal feelings. I want to do good too. Thank you.
Alright, thank you very much, Robert, for that insightful talk. Our next speaker was formerly a researcher at Giving What We Can, grant writer for the Oxford Institute for Effective Altruism. He is currently a PhD candidate at the Australian National University. His research looks at infinite ethics, which I honestly don't understand at all. Looking forward to your talk on that tomorrow. But for now, he'll be going into more detail in more in depth into what cause prioritization is and why it's important. So please welcome to the stage, Hayden. I forgot to write down your last name. We'll be soon. Here we go.
Testing. Is that all right?
And
now is why, when we're doing good, we probably also want to prioritize. So, suppose you're a firefighter. There are two houses burning down, but you only have one hose, and you can only put out one or two fires. One house has one person trapped in it, and the other has 200 people trapped in it. So, depending on where you point your hose, you can save one person, or you can save 200. Maybe you can't even see them. Maybe your firefighter buddy pulls out the telephone book, or something like that, and says, "Wow, look at this data. Only one person lives in that house." I think it's that way. But 200 people living out. That's the only difference you know of, and everything else in this situation is equal. But even if, say, you know that one person is Australian, or has something like that in common with you, it's the same football thing, something that isn't really relevant, morally relevant, doing that thing, maybe the 200 are from some other country. I don't think that changes anything, unless you actually care about Australians, or Rooster supporters, 200 times more than people overseas, or international. It's true that saving either house full of people is better than doing nothing, obviously. Even saving just one person is a really good result. But at the same time, you can do so much better. If you consider the information, you take the data into account, there's 200 times more people in one of the houses, and there seems to be additional reason to save them. With only one hose, you might as well point at the house where 200 people could die rather than the house with one person. You can save more lives. You'll have a far greater impact, and 200 people are going to be really thankful that you did. And in analogous case comes up with charities. Three choices. I have, say, $1,000 to donate to a charity. I could donate it to the charity with the best advertising campaign, or a pet cause. For instance, my grandma died of cancer not long ago, so at the time I considered donating to an Australian cancer charity. But charities in the first world, it can't actually be much with the same donation. The cost is so much higher. And so on and so forth. But even if I donated to a cancer charity in a low-income country, my donation still wouldn't go very far. Apologies if you've heard this example before, perhaps 7,000 times. Say I spent it on treating Kaposi's sarcoma, which is a cancer that's commonly developed by people with HIV. My $1,000, it would buy someone at most 8 extra weeks of life. In Australia, that would be even less. That would be a really good deal in Australia. Of course, there are more effective interventions for HIV. $1,000 spent on antiretrovirals would keep someone alive for 2 years rather than 8 weeks. $1,000 spent on condom distribution would save 10 years of healthy life. And if you look more broadly, $1,000 spent on bed nets to prevent malaria, through the Anti-Malaria Foundation, for instance, would save 30 years of health and life. So that's about 200 times more impact than I'd have treating Kaposi's sarcoma. And far, far more than I get from practically any charity in high-income countries like Australia. You might already be seeing the link between this and the firefighter example. In reality, there are fires raging every day. 16,000 children die every day from preventable diseases that they just can't afford to treat. Around the world, all combined, 151,000 people die every day from every possible cause. There's an enormous amount of death and suffering in the world, and we simply can't reach all of it. I'm not that rich. You're great. We don't have infinitely many fire hoses, and presumably we don't have infinite money. So we do need to prioritize. If we put our donations and our time towards really cost-effective interventions, which save hundreds of times more lives, then we're able to do a lot more good, just like if we point our fire hose right at the house of the people. So of course, making any effort and donating to any charity is fantastic, but we also care about the outcome. And we probably think that death and suffering are bad, regardless of which disease happened to cause it, so we might as well go for the even more effective charities. We might as well prioritize. On that note, here's a graph. This is the cost effectiveness of different health interventions, out of the disease primary disease control primary disorder. On the left are things which only have a little impact, and the right are the more effective interventions, those which save lives, prevent more suffering for the same donation. And how high the graph is represents how many interventions have that level of effectiveness. And the sad thing is, as you can see, most of them have pretty low impact. About 70% aren't even statistically significant, I think the stat is, something like that. And the sad thing is, as you can see, yeah, they mostly have quite low impact. It's pretty rare for an intervention or a charity to have a really big impact, because there, as you can see, there aren't many programs in society where we're not there. So one key point is that if you're a big charity at random, we'll almost definitely land somewhere on the left. Find charities that are having a really big impact, they're having pretty hard. And do some research, we certainly won't pick them by random, at random. Thankfully, places like GiveWell and the Open Philanthropy Project already do this. So to stretch the firearm example out even further, we suggest that if we're just pointing out around willy-nilly, we're not going to do a whole lot of good, because most of the houses only have one person. A few houses have hundreds, and we need to do a little bit of fact-checking to figure out which ones those are. So before I finish up, there's one final point I'd like to make, and that is that there may be interventions or charities which don't just work on health and poverty, which are way up here on the effectiveness scale, having far more impact. Yeah, there's the there. Having far more impact than all the other things on the graph that just would report on that. That'll depend not just on the effectiveness of charity, things like neglecting this accountability and so on, but also on some crucial moral judgments. For instance, do you think animal lives or animal suffering is it worth at least 100th as much as human lives and human suffering? If so, for you and your values, some of the best animal charities will end up being way more effective than the very most effective charities for humans. Do you think that saving habitat and preserving the environment is more important than human life? Would you value, say, 15 acres of rainforest or preventing 1,000 tons of CO2 being emitted more than one human life? If so, then you may find some really good opportunities in effective environmental conservation. Or do you think that future generations have at least some small value? If someone never been born or been born into a far worse life, is at least just 1,000th as bad as someone experienced present suffering or loss of life? If you think it is, then with your values, you might find some really amazing opportunities to do good by working on threats to future generations, say nuclear war or pandemics, or even media things like artificial intelligence. So these sorts of considerations, they're crucial for working out which charities and which broader causes will allow us to do the most good. And we do need to prioritise, not just among individual charities, but among broader cause areas like animal welfare and poverty, if we're going to find interventions which are just completely off the charts. So I'd really encourage you all to take advantage of this weekend and go out and find out about areas that you're totally not familiar with and hadn't considered before. Check out the AI talk, check out the animals talk, and all the others too. Look for amazing opportunities and make a judgment on whether they are actually amazing based on your own moral views, because the goal here is to do a whole lot of good. And if you can find more effective ways to do it, then the more good you can do. Thank you.
Thank you, Caleb. So we now have a break, but we're running a bit late, so we'll get you to come back for 25 past for a start at 10:30. So just quickly, a reminder, if you have a project you'd like to collaborate on with people at the conference, strongly encourage you to go on to FlexiTime, eagxaustralia.com FlexiTime, and put that down. And the same goes if you have an interesting discussion topic and you want to have a bit of a discussion group. Go on to eagxaustralia.com/FlexiTime and propose that. That's happening this afternoon and tomorrow morning. And also, apply for career coaching, because Peter McIntyre is awesome, and he's in here all day just to do that. And career coaching is up there too. Alright, so we'll see you back here in 10 minutes. Enjoy some interesting conversations. update you on police events.